Good morning. Welcome. Glad that you're here to worship with us today. We are just glad to be able to honor our Lord today. It's my hope this morning that as we come and worship Him and celebrate what He's doing and sing and hear from His Word, that His Spirit will be working in our life and it'll affect the way in which we interact with those around us and how we indeed show that God has loved us and show our love for God by how we love those around us. So let's open up our hearts, our minds, to what God is going to do for us this morning. And let's let His Spirit continue to work in us.
Our call to worship is Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. If you stand with me, we'll worship together in song.
Worship His holy name.
Heavenly Father, we come to you today asking indeed that you would do that refining work in us, that Heavenly Father, you would make us to be more and more like you. Heavenly Father, we come to this service today thankful that we can bring whatever burdens us, whatever concerns us before you and before your throne. And so, Heavenly Father, whether it is something going on in our area, a personal hurt or concern or sorrow, Heavenly Father, we're thankful that we can come and bring that before you today. Lord, if it is something much bigger, bigger than we can imagine, bigger than we can handle, things totally outside our control, Lord, we're glad we can bring that to you today as well. Lord, indeed, we have seen what happens when it seems like a nation that understands power and how to use it stops using it, and a world that understands power and how to use it fills that void. And Lord, it's easy to look around at a world and at areas of the world that are falling apart and going, Lord, what happens? How do we imagine what living faithfully to Jesus looks like when it seems like all that this world is a constant struggle of power and violence? Heavenly Father, we're thankful that in areas that are well beyond what we can imagine or even influence, that Lord, you might be able to do something. You might be able to move in a way that we can't even begin to fathom at this point. And Lord, we pray that for our world. We pray that for those who are hurting. We pray that for Afghanistan. Heavenly Father, we pray that for people who are stuck there. And Lord, in some ways, as we imagine that big situation, there are areas in our life too that blow up. And we go, wait, what's going to happen here? And Lord, we need to know that when we turn to you, that again, you can do things bigger than what we can ever imagine, what we can begin to fathom. And so, Lord, today, we come to this house of worship asking that your Spirit would continue to be with us, and that we would see hope and we'd see a future, and that we would see indeed that you are the God who continues to call us to faithfulness and to holiness, and that you can indeed refine us, and we might be surprised at just how you move in our life and in our world. And so, Heavenly Father, bless this time, remainder of this service, from our singing, the giving we are about to do, the hearing of your word, everything, Lord, may we find ourselves yearning to be faithful to you. Pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would like to give this morning, feel free to come forward and leave your offering at the offering plate. Thank you.
Good morning. Our first scripture lesson is 1 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. When the time drew near for David to die, he gave a charge to Solomon his son. "I'm about to go the way of all the earth," he said. "So be strong, act like a man, and observe what the Lord your God requires. Walk in obedience to him and keep his decrees and commands, his laws and regulations as written in the law of Moses. Do this so that you may prosper in all you do and wherever you go, that the Lord may keep his promises to me. If your descendants watch how they live, if they walk faithfully before me with all their heart and soul, you will never fail to have a successor on the throne of Israel." Amen.
This is Isaiah 29, 13 to 16. The Lord says, "These people come near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship of me is made up only of rules taught by men. Therefore, once more, I will astound these people with wonder upon wonder. The wisdom of the wise will perish. The intelligence of the intelligent will vanish. Woe to those who go to great depths to hide their plans from the Lord, who do their work in darkness and think, 'Who sees us? Who will know us? Who will know?' You turn things upside down as if the potter were thought to be like the clay. Shall what is formed say to him who formed it, 'He did not make me'? Can the pot say of the potter, 'He knows nothing'?" And could we just pray for our military? I know there's many people here who have military in their family, and I've had so many military. Only one is in it now. But could we just take a minute to pray for? Amen. Thank you. This is not about me, it's about us.
I invite you to stand if you wish.
Give me only to wait till I get all the Amen. Please be seated.
The scripture reference for today is from Mark chapter 7, verses 1 through 23. It says, "The Pharisees and some of the teachers of the law who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus, saw some of his disciples eating food with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. The Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they give their hands a ceremonial washing, holding to the tradition of the elders. And when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And they observe many other traditions, such as the washing of cups and pitchers and kettles. And so the Pharisees and teachers of the law asked Jesus, why don't your disciples live according to the tradition of the elders instead of eating their food with defiled hands? And he replied, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites. As it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules. You have let go of the commands of God and are holding on to human traditions." And he continued, "You have a fine way of setting out aside the commands of God in order to observe your own traditions. For Moses said, honor your father and mother, and anyone who curses their father or mother is to be put to death. But you say that if anyone declares that what might have been used to help their father or mother is Corban," that's devoted to God, "then you no longer let them do anything for their father and mother. Thus you nullify the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down, and you do many things like that." And again, Jesus called the crowd to him and said, "Listen to me, everyone, and understand this. Nothing outside a person can defile them by going into them. Rather, it's what comes out of a person that defiles them." And after he had left the crowd and entered the house, his disciples asked him about this parable. "Are you so dull?" he asked. "Don't you see that nothing that enters a person from the outside can defile them? For it doesn't go into their heart, but into their stomach, and then out the body." And in saying this, Jesus declared all foods clean. And he went on, "What comes out of a person is what defiles them. For it is from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come. Sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and defile a person." This passage of Scripture in Mark chapter 7 focuses quite a bit on some of the very traditions that they had, the laws and the rules that they had, the things that they knew that they were following, things that, if we remember what was said in 2 Kings, that this is part of the rules that were part of the promise of the kingship of David, right? You follow all these, you're golden. And so here they are approaching him. And there are a lot of traditions that after a while we just don't remember why we keep them, right? We're like, wait a minute. Like, I just do this way because it's just how I've always done things. Or this is just what you're supposed to do, right? You got any traditions like that where you're like, oh, this is just kind of how we do things. And so I remember when Jen and I were getting married. We're on our wedding day, we were about to get married. Now, weddings are all full of all kinds of weird traditions, right? You have all kinds of, there are particular songs that are done. There's particular looks and all that kind of stuff. There's so much about a wedding that is traditional. But most of those traditions gets described to us somewhere in the planning phases, in the wedding magazines, in the rehearsal. All those kind of just get reminded to us, and we know why we're doing it. But there are some traditions that you might just be like, wait, what? And so let me explain what happens this day. So this day, we're supposed to get to the church early, right? It's a wedding. Everyone needs to get ready. You know, the girls are making sure that their hair's done right, their makeup's done right. Us guys, we have it hard. We just got to make sure our tie isn't crooked. And so, you know, here we are. We're there at the church. We're early. And we're just, you know, we're getting ready. And one of the traditions, of course, is that the bride doesn't see the groom, and so we're in a different area of the church. So I have no clue of the stress that is building on the bride's side, because we were supposed to get there a couple hours early, but someone didn't show up early that was fully expected to be there early, to be there to help make sure things were going smoothly. In fact, it got very close to the start of the wedding time when finally Jen's mom showed up. And she's like, wait, what? Where have you been? And she said, I almost forgot the most important wedding gift that everyone needs to have at their wedding. And so I had to stop at Walmart and get this. And that wedding gift that we still have today was this. She was nearly late to the wedding for a rolling pin. Now, I do not understand this. I have no clue why someone had a rolling pin. Is she thinking, you know, somehow, you know, Jen's going to be making stuff? Or is she thinking she's going to be running around the house, you know, waving this thing at me? I just don't know. And so if anyone here knows after the sermon, please let me know, is this a tradition or was this just in her mind? But this was a part of, like, this was for her an important thing, right? You have to have a rolling pin. For whatever reason, it makes the wedding gift. And so so we went into that wedding, and she was there for the wedding in time, but just, you know, made us a little bit nervous. And so that's one of those kind of traditions. Like, wait, why do we do that again? I don't know. The story in the Bible begins with a tradition. And it's one that's happened so long that the people start to forget why they did it. In fact, it's so well known that they forgot why they're spending all this time in the cleanliness rituals that Mark reminds them why. You know, just in case they forgot they need to wash their hands. He says, oh, don't you remember this is our tradition here? It's like when we go to dinner and Jen reminds Alex, hey, go wash your hands, dinner's ready. Then she turns to our teenage, now adult son and says, did you wash your hands? And then she turns to me and says, Tim, did you wash your hands? I'm an adult. What do you mean, did I wash my hands? Of course. Why are you reminding me to wash my hands? But, you know, like father, like son. She's just making sure I didn't forget. And so Mark has been telling us this whole story about Jesus, right? There are phrases like Son of Man. There are activities like baptism. He talks about Pharisees. There's Old Testament quotations. He mentions the temple. There's all kinds of other specifically Jewish references. And yet Mark decides, hey, I'm going to remind you why we wash our hands. You know, just making sure you didn't forget. And so this is what he does for us. Now let's talk a little bit about this hand washing. Early when I was first reading the scriptures, when I would hear about these different cleanliness rituals in the Old Testament, everything from how they would wash their hands before eating, before going to the temple, how they would have all these different cleanliness rites. Early on, as I heard about this, it was always centered and described to me as a people who are instituting these rules and these laws to help keep their new community safe. They've been freed from slavery. They're going into the promised land. They're forming a new nation. And these holiness codes, what you can eat, what you can't eat, these cleanliness practices are recorded in large part because it was a part of their law, part of their identity. And they wanted to create an identity that would help keep their community safe. I mean, we could go into a courthouse here and we would find volumes and volumes of laws in the books. But it took our country and our state hundreds of years to articulate those laws and to get all those written down. Early on in our country's history, or early on in our state's history, we didn't have nearly as many laws as we have now. And it was the same for them, although they were a far less documented society. And so those laws, those important ones that they wanted to preserve, they made sure were written down as a part of their documents and a part of their faith. And so what we have is, in large part, a description of laws instituted to help them succeed as a nation. I mean, turns out the very earliest nation states instituted cleanliness rules to help stop the spread of disease and infection. It's not a novel concept. It's kind of biblical. Yet as much as we're reminded of this piece of the cleanliness practices, there's another reason as well, as I studied this more and more. The cleanliness practices had a greater purpose. It was also part of their understanding of God and their understanding of sin and holiness. If God is so much greater than we are, and God is unchanging and never changing, then their idea of holiness was something that remained normal and remained the same, and something that was Now, so it was abnormal to be dirty. It was abnormal to be in a state that was different from the rest of normal life. So it didn't matter. So it's not normal to engage and touch dead bodies. For them, it wasn't. It's not normal to have diseases or to bleed or to have whatever else. And so, any flaw, any mark, any disease, they would see as falling short of holiness. And they had a word for this. And that word that we most often translate, we translate to unclean. Unclean. To be holy, on the other hand, is to be without a flaw, to be without a spot. So they would sacrifice animals without spots. It would be without stain. It is to be clean. There's an old hymn, perhaps you know it. 'Tis a glorious church without spot or wrinkle. A hymn that is looking to the church triumphant. The church triumphant is a phrase we use for the church after Jesus comes back. It's a hymn that looks to the church in anticipation of when Jesus comes and removes sin from the world. And it purposefully uses Old Testament language about holiness. It's not talking about this church or the present church in the world. I mean, we don't have to look very far to be like, oh, the church has some spots and wrinkles, right? I mean, we can just, look at our neighbor, or if we're really serious, let's look at our seat, right? Like, the church has spots, but it's a song that looks to the future. When Jesus comes back, removes sin, and it uses Old Testament language to talk about this holiness without spot or wrinkle. There's another example of kind of weird traditions I want to talk about that we have. So grilling out, there's some weird tradition with that. I have this in my bag here. This was given to me at the church I went to in seminary. And there is a weird tradition with grill tongs. Whenever you pick one up, you have to make sure it works. Like, isn't that just a weird tradition? Like, why do we do that? Every time you pick these up, yep, got the tongs, we're ready to go. And when you're grilling like burgers on the grill, right? There is nothing more satisfying than and all that grease and fat just drips onto the fire and lights up. Like, I don't know why, but we all do this. My dad did this. My uncle did this. My uncle, the one who had taught me a couple years ago, remember when I brought when we brought like a coffee can, put butter in it to dip the corn on the cob at our picnic, that we're at, which, by the way, is in the bulletin. Make sure you go to that. Bring people to it. I didn't mention in the welcome announcements, but I want you there. We're going to have a great time. But like, everyone does it. I was with a few years ago, Alex had T-ball in South Portland, and it was many years ago. And I remember opening day, they had this big grill out, and they were just like, celebrating, T-ball season starting up or whatever. And sure enough, every time the person would pick up the tongs to flip the burgers, you'd hear a little clack, and then a psst, psst. And they weren't even homemade patties, right? They're nice and big and juicy. They were just the frozen ones too, but still, gotta hear that sizzle. Like, that's just what we do. It's like part of grilling. And one time I remember going to see Tim Brooks. He was pastor at South Portland. You guys might remember him. He even came preach here during your first interim after John Twitchell moved to San Diego. And but before he came here, he was in Florida, and I went to visit him for a week. And I remember one of the times we were grilling out, and I said, hey, I can do that if you want. He said, sure, no problem. And he said to me, I want mine medium. I said, medium? Burgers? Medium? Why would you do that? That's not good, because, the idea is like a steak, you can do that medium, right? Because like, you're searing the outside, and the inside meat that's pink has never seen the air, all that kind of stuff. But a hamburger, you've mashed, you've got your hands in it, it's been out in the air. You're supposed to cook that well done. I said, why would you do that? He said, I don't want it dry. I said, oh, this is the well done juicy challenge. All right, let's do this. And so I'm like, no, this will be good. This is going to be the best well-done burger you've ever had. It's going to be dripping with juice. I got this. And so sure enough, I set it up, and we make the patties. I put it out on the grill, and the tongs are sitting out on the side of the grill, and we're just chatting, we're just talking. And sure enough, he reaches over, does one of these numbers, and then he, and I'm like, Tim, what are you doing? What are you doing? Stop it. What are you doing? He's like, I'm just, I'm just patting the patties. You know, this is what everyone does. I'm just listening to the sizzle. You know, we're just, and I'm like, no. That's the juiciness. That's the goodness right there that you're just letting out and letting the fire taste instead of letting us taste. Said, you can't do that. You can't do that. I mean, if you want hockey pucks, you can do that. But no, that's not how you make a juicy burger. But everyone wants to smash that burger. But it defeats the purpose for why we're there. To eat good food. To show that we're masters of the flame. That's why we grill, right? Because we're hungry. Or maybe we want to show, hey, I can still cook over a flame like my ancestors did. You know, whatever reason it is, that's why we cook. And there are weird traditions that go with it. But one of the things I've learned is, if you want a good burger, don't flatten it. You have to resist the tradition. Don't flatten it and only flip it once. And it's perfect. It comes out great that way. But remember this story because it's kind of essential what's happening in our scripture. The Pharisees say to Jesus, there's some cleaning practices that need to take place. And we're called to be the holy people of God. We're supposed to be an example to the nations. How can we do that if we're just as dirty as our neighbors? I mean, that's the mindset. We got to be better than that. And Jesus tells them, you forgot the whole reason we have the rules that we have. The purpose of the rules isn't just to fall in line. If you want to follow traditions for the sake of tradition, if you want to make sure people fall in line, all the while forgetting that the love of God is about the very people we're concerned about, then we're going to have some really dried out faith. And of course, the Pharisees are going to claim that their focus is on honoring God. But Jesus calls them out on this. And so he uses an example. And the example, I don't know if it was a particular example of an individual that they knew or if it was general practice. They just don't know. But he says, hey, you guys know this story. There's a guy who needs to take care of his parents. And it's a part of the Ten Commandments, right? But has learned that if he devotes those resources to God, he doesn't have to spend those resources. He doesn't have to waste those resources on his parents. And so there's a word for that, for Corbin to say, hey, you know what? This is devoted to God. I'm just gonna hold on to it or whatever. And Jesus reminds them, what you think you're doing for God is breaking one of the commandments, one of the Ten Commandments, the Big Ten, you know, etched in stone commandments: honor your father and mother. So Jesus, in many ways, redefines holiness. Holiness is never about what I do or what I don't do. It's not that individualistic. Holiness is always about how I live among others God has put in my life. Holiness is always about how we love our neighbor, about how we love those whom God puts us face to face with. This is why Jesus says nothing outside a person can defile them. Only what comes out of them. It is how God is magnified in our lives that makes all the difference. And this is a good thing because if Jesus invites us to be an example with the world, if we're rubbing shoulders with people who are dirty, with people who are unclean, with people who have spots, with people who smash hamburger patties into grills, then guess what? We're going to be an exposed people. We might be in areas that people deem questionable. But who we are and the faith that we have is exemplified in how we treat those around us. There's another parenthetical comment that Mark gives in this chapter. It's another kind of weird reminder. In verse 19, he tells us that Jesus is declaring all foods clean. Well, that's kind of unusual. Like, this passage isn't even primarily about food. It's about what he's doing to our understanding of holiness and how we live faithfully to God. But he goes ahead and tells us, by the way, all food is clean. This is something that the church didn't wrestle with until Peter saw a vision of the cloth that came down with all kinds of animals that they were deemed unclean. Yeah, the other nations might eat it, but we don't. We are a separate, we are a unique, we are a clean people. And God told him to eat. And when he said, oh, I don't know, I've never done that before. And God said, don't call anything I have made unclean. And so Mark inserts I think, that idea, because of course the Gospel of Mark is written after Peter's experience and reminds us that Jesus is absolutely changing the understanding of holiness. It's no longer just about what comes in. It's about how we live among God's creation. Even the list, I mean, after all, holiness is again, not what I avoid. Holiness is how I love with the grace of God. Holiness is like seeing myself in the neighbor, but actually I don't even like saying that. It's seeing God in my neighbor, not myself. As Jesus said, whatever you did for the least of these, you did for me. This is what he says in Matthew 25 when he talks about those whom they have cared for. And he says, whatever you did for them, you did for me. The reason I don't like saying, oh, see myself in someone else, because what happens when I see myself in someone else is I live by certain rules, certain parameters of living, of what I think helps me live faithfully to God. And if I see myself in somebody else, when they don't live by those same rules, I go, oh, I wouldn't have done that. That was boneheaded. I probably would have done it. But I say, oh, I wouldn't have done that. So then all of a sudden I'm judging them. Why? Because I am defining them by myself rather than by God, by who He is. So let us remember why we live out our faith the way that we do. We want to honor God. We want to love our neighbor, and that's it. I mean, those are the two big commandments. And we're going to run into people with whom we disagree. They may be people who show up late. They may be people who purposely do things specifically that we don't approve of. And they may be people close to us, friends, adult children. But we need to remember, the very reason we have the rules by which we live by, the guidelines, the parameters that we have around us, or around our children, or around those who invite to get really close to us and are close friends, is because we know they've served us well, and we think it'll serve them well as well. So when we let those issues become barriers to the very people we love or are called to love, then we're missing the mark. We're not being the holy people God called us to be. We're not being the royal nation, a people set apart by God. Let me illustrate this. So I invited Jen to go and see my grandparents when we were dating. But actually, I think this conversation might have happened after we were married. And so, but anyway, in one of those meetings with my grandparents, she's having a conversation with my grandmother. My grandmother's talking to her and finding out what she's doing, what she's studying. So maybe we were still dating at the time. And anyway, she says she's a writer, and she's writing, and she's working on some books and stuff like that. And my grandmother says something to her. You see, she had certain parameters that she lived by. She had rules that she had lived by that were important to her. And so she wanted to share those, because that's what you do with people you care about. You say, hey, this is something I think is a good idea. You wouldn't tell someone something that you thought they should do or something they should avoid if you didn't care about them. And so she told her that in her writing, she better not have any swear words in any books that she writes. That would not be good, because that's part of the way she lived her life. Is she did not curse at all, and she thought, you know, that would be terrible. That rule, that guideline for her life fit for her very well, and she was explaining that to Jen. Actually, I think her exact words were, if you have swear words in one of your books, I'm going to disown you. But nonetheless, right? That is what she's saying. There are parameters and rules of living that have served her well. Ones that she'd like to impress upon people with whom she cared about. But if Jen, for whatever reason, were to decide that in a book she was writing that there was a character that had a PG mouth, and if my grandmother, who's no longer with us, but if she was, had read that and said, oh, now I have to disown you, she would have been making the rule the end, the objective, and not the very person she cared enough about to say, these are rules of living I live by that have been good to me, and I think they'll be good for you, right? Then we are absolutely putting the cart before the horse. And Jesus is reminding us that true faith is found in community with one another. Without a doubt, we have opportunities to share and to extend life with one another, and even to speak words of encouragement and words of advice to people in our life, based on how God has blessed us, based off the rules of living and the parameters that we've set up that help us live holy to God, that we think will help others. But when that becomes the end or the objective, we forget the whole reason we have them in the first place is because God has called us to love those neighbors with whom we are so interested in. We said, hey, let me tell you what I think would be a good idea. Even the end of this chapter, Mark has a list of things that he says. Now, these are the kinds of things that show you've been defiled. And it's very easy for us just to fall back into, okay, so this is what I have to avoid now. Got it. But each and every item in that list affects somebody else. Each and every sin that he lists in verses 21 and 22, not a single one of them is a victimless crime. Every single one affects somebody else. And so Jesus is reminding us again, even with that list, that our holiness to God affects the way in which we treat and respond and live among one another. And when we forget that the advice, that the encouragement, that the suggestions we have given to other people based on how we have found to be a healthy and helpful way for us to follow God, when that gets ahead of the very people we are concerned about, we've missed the mark. We have completely jumped the shark. We are missed, indeed, what God has called us to do. So Jesus reminds us again today that holiness is in how we serve God and serve one another. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, today, it is my hope and it is my prayer that we would hear from this, a story that reminds us again and again that what should be most important in our life and in our faith are the very people you have put before us. Heavenly Father, help us not to judge or to put our own expectations over any other person. Help us remember that that is the whole reason we are passionate about what we are passionate about, why we care about what we care about, why we approach and offer advice in the first place, is always and at all times the very people you have put in our life. Help us indeed to love our neighbor as ourselves, as you have called us to do. I pray, Heavenly Father, that that word rings far more clearly than any grill advice I gave. Heavenly Father, I pray that you help us remember that you have called us to live faithfully to you and to one another. And that is indeed how we will learn to be a holy people, a sanctified people, living for you, O Lord. Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Before we sing our closing, we're going to come and we're going to receive Holy Communion. It is a sacrament that reminds us again of just how Jesus has given himself for God's creation. And may we come and also come willing to give ourselves wherever God has put us in love and in service to one another. And so you're welcome to come forward. And if you are uncomfortable with coming forward and receiving the elements, I understand. But you are welcome to receive the bread and the juice at this time. Thank you. It is my hope that in receiving these elements, practice that we do fairly regularly, that each time we do so would be a way in which we do so prayerfully, asking indeed that the Lord would impress upon us what we've heard and perhaps what He has already spoken to our hearts. Then receiving these elements, we are indeed asking that the grace and love of our Lord would be with us as we go and as we serve the people whom God puts before us. This is the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was broken for us. May it preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Take and eat this in remembrance. This is the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink this in remembrance and be thankful. Hymn 496 will be our closing hymn, Living for Jesus.
You can stand with us if you wish.
Jesus, Lord.
Today you learn that there's one tradition I had to give up. No more sizzling. That maybe there are things that we realize, hey, you know what? I put before those whom God has put in my life. May God restore and remind us the importance of the people He has put before us. May we love boldly with the grace and mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.